Good evening, Ugandans. Today, we are with the acting managing director of the National Social Security Fund, Mr. Patrick Ayota. And he is here to update us about what is going on this, in the fund. He has also been in the spotlight in the media because of the ad hoc committee of parliament that was investigating his entity. We would like to know what is going on there now that we are not seeing that investigation in the public. Mm-hmm. Good evening, sir.
Good evening. How are you?
I'm very well, thank you. Thank you for honoring our invite.
You're welcome.
Now, NSSF has been in the media.
Yes.
In the past weeks.
Yes.
Is all well?
All is well. There were a few issues that came up, and that's what Parliament was investigating. I think they're running through or writing their reports. We're waiting for the findings with those reports. But otherwise, from a fundamental perspective, from operational perspective, from safety of member fund, the fund is doing well.
Oh, that is good to hear, because we remember the last time, just a few months ago, the NSSF was at ease and everything seemed to be going on very well. You were appointed acting MD and your contract was renewed. The former MD's contract was also expected to be renewed, Mr. Richard Biarugaba. And then we get into an investigation. What are they investigating?
No, there were certain allegations that came through. And if you look at Parliament, you look at the ministers concerned, I think the idea is they needed to go through that. If someone makes an allegation, don't just push it under the floor, because it doesn't even exonerate the fund if you do. So I think they opted, let's go ahead and investigate. And where that leads to so that if the fund has a clean play to go on, there are no suspicions running around. So actually, in a way, we did welcome it because it can lay bare what the truth is and talking about the fund. There were allegations of things we had done, maybe we hadn't followed the processes properly, some allegations of fraudulent activities, but we opened ourselves up, so okay, check and see.
One of the issues that came up around that time was the fact that NSSF was now going to be lending to government directly, which is against the law, because you were supposed to be lending to government through the institutions and the other financial mechanisms of treasury bills, the treasury bonds, and now you're going directly. How far is that?
I can actually assure you, this government has not tried to borrow money direct from NSSF because it's illegal. There is actually a law that says we cannot lend money except through like treasury bonds and treasury bills. And that's the instrument we use. So if that was an allegation, but that was totally bogus because they didn't try, nobody tried. Even from our end, nobody even tried to lend to the government. We cannot do it.
So what allegations were there when the investigation started?
No, I mean, it's just, little things to me which come up. Some people are not happy with the fund, other people. But that's all.
Is that in fighting at the fund?
Not, I don't know whether it was really in fighting, but anything can come from any direction. The fund is big. We can't presume to say everybody likes the fund. We cannot presume to say because we're there that we will not make mistakes. No, we won't. We will make mistakes. We are humans. So when these things come up, actually for the integrity of the fund, you investigate.
So you were running the fund very well.
We still do.
Interesting. So how did we get here then?
It happens. I mean, I don't really think it's strange. I think there's a point at which somebody, if they want to do something, allege anything, can and will say. You can't stop anybody from alleging anything. And the responsible thing to do is basically investigate.
Very interesting when you say allegations, because you do remember that moment where an MP was questioning one of your employees and was asking him about the relatives.
Yes.
At the fund.
Yes.
How did that happen?
No, but you see, that's the other thing. If you look at an incidence in isolation from the totality of the fund, you can actually get a very wrong impression. This specific employee explained. He says, first of all, he has a department with over 300 employees. Over 300 employees. He said, most of them, about six, there were six out of the eight that were saying, all of them did not come directly to his department. In fact, what happened is they came in through other departments, and as opportunities opened up, they do. Now the fund has a policy. The policy is, if you're my relative, you can come to and work in the fund. There are ways and how that is done, how you come to the fund, you will come in on merit. So because you're my relative, it doesn't mean you don't work in the fund. No, but there is a process that you go through to do that. And when we verified, the process had been followed. And it was okay. It was really unfortunate that they pulled up one little thing and made it like it was a general practice. And it's not.
Are there other employees who have their relatives at the fund other than that one?
Yeah, there could be. I don't really know how many there are, but there could be. You know, there could be. But people come on merit. The thing is, NSF has actually perfected the art of bringing people on merit, and we do.
Yes. Mm. Are you bothered by any of the issues that came up during that probe?
Apart from, it kind of, for the last 2 months, instead of focusing on the things we know how best to do, we're responding. So it's 2 months of time spent doing something that we're not planning to do. But otherwise, it comes with punches. You have to learn to say, okay, this is here, let's deal with it, and you continue.
Should the server be worried about what transpired?
No. Two areas, one. One of the attributes we have, and so we have got three things we promise our members. Three. One, safety of their money. It comes in two parts, physical safety and then preservation of value. That's why every year when we begin, our budgeting starts with, this is the amount of interest we are going to give our members. We plan it to. I can't even tell you that number. It's 200 basis points or 2 percentage points above 10-year average inflation. We start with that because that preserves value. Number two, what we promise our members is convenience. It informs the type of IT systems we buy. It informs the processes we undergo. It informs how even our staff serve you. Number two. Number three, empowerment. Now, this is where the amendments help us, because now we can help members deal not just with the long-term needs they have retirement, but now once the regulations come out, you can save for 5 years, 3 years, 7 years, so that you don't have to wait. If you have a need that's short-term, you can deal with it. So those are the three things. We call them value proposition to our members, and those three are still the same. Now, if you look at the investment of the fund, because that's where I normally you say,
Just before we get to investments, are you confident that the report that is being written by Parliament is going to exonerate you?
I can't be confident that it will be, because I don't have sight of it. But I think as a fund, they will actually find that if you are really fair and you see what the fund does, it would be a standard report. It should be.
Now, off to your strategy.
Yes.
Your investment strategy. Mm-hmm. You should tell us in brief, how would you describe NSSF's investment strategy?
Okay. Remember I said one of the things that we want to deliver to the member is safety. And the way we do that is interesting. Today, an NSSF member cannot lose any money. What do I mean by that? If you have 100 million shillings at the beginning of the year with NSSF, the least that will happen to your money, it will go up by to 102 million. It will never go down to 99, 98, 95, 90. It will never go backwards. If you notice what has happened over the last 10 years, we've actually given interest that's higher than inflation. I mean, 2018, 15%, 12%. Last year it was 9.65%. those interest rates are amazing to the member. So we've done that. Now, how do we get to that?
Yes, when you say amazing, I do understand, because you're also the biggest fund in East Africa.
Correct.
I think it is an interesting factor because the Kenyan economy is much bigger than us. So if you can do better than they actually do,
yes,
in terms of the social security fund, then I think you're doing a good job.
But remember, we grew. It's
yes,
not that we've always been big.
Yes.
I mean, 11 years ago, 2011, we're around 2 trillion shillings. Today, we're 18 trillion shillings. That's a growth of over 9 times. When you look at actually from a percentage perspective, year on year, you would say you've grown around 15% in an economy that's growing at 5 to 6%. So actually, the fund has actually done very well. Members have actually trusted us with their money.
Did the COVID-19 pandemic have any impact on you?
What was interesting with COVID was we actually gave employers breathing space. They could defer their contribution to NSSF because we thought a lot of companies are going to go under a lot of stress. They would need cash flows and things like that. So we gave them room to do that. Interestingly enough, that was the beginning of COVID. By June, most of the employers submitted their money because they wanted to make sure that their money was with the fund by the time we declared interest. So it was really interesting that from that perspective, we collected exactly what we had budgeted for the year before COVID. And it worked out well.
Didn't that create a number of issues with the employees who may not have known that you had given a waiver for their employers not to remit that money to you?
No, it did not. Because, you know, the thing is, COVID caught every person by surprise. And the idea was, what did you need to do to survive? Not the fund, but for that member, for that employer to survive. And people understood. And they remitted all their money, which actually helped a lot.
Okay. Does the fund have investments overseas?
Yes.
What kind of investments?
We have, the law allows us to invest within the East African countries. And that is Kenya, Tanzania, Rwanda. Of course, Burundi would be, but we don't have anything in Burundi. We mostly have things in Kenya. Kenya is the largest stock exchange. So, of course, our stock holdings is going to be bigger in Kenya than in Uganda. The good thing is we've invested that money in what we call the blue chip stocks, Safaricom, say Kenya Breweries, say KCBs and so on. That from Kenya, that from Nairobi. What we also invested in Kenya and Tanzania are their treasury bonds. For example, they have got very good rates in Kenya, very good rates in Tanzania, but the bulk of the government bonds we have are Ugandan bonds.
Okay. For the last couple of years, the NSSF has embarked on a digital roadmap. Is that true?
Yes.
Yes.
That's why one of the things that is interesting about NSF today is the fact that, first of all, the digital journey we went on, we are paperless. If you come, you rarely will see paper. In fact, what we tell members now, where you are, like if you want to apply for your midterm, you want to contribute your money, you want to register with NSF, do it from the comfort of your home.
How do they do that?
For example, if you want registration with NSSF, you just get on our website, put in your name, and it will die nearer and populate the biodata NIRA has into the fields we have. Which makes it very easy, because then when you're doing midterm, you're applying for midterm, you can do the same process now. You can actually put and will confirm it's you, confirm your bank, and within 3 to 5 days, that money is in your bank. It will take longer if you come and you want to fill a piece of paper. Most Ugandans still want to come to a branch. They still want to fill out paper. Now, that becomes a paper process we undertake. But otherwise, the digital journey has actually been amazing in terms of being able to deliver value to our members.
The card issue came under scrutiny.
Yes.
During the probe, mm-hmm, at Parliament.
Yes.
And the former MD, actually, Mr. Richard Biarugaba, said it was a mistake.
We learned from the card. What happened is, what people don't realize is we've had two sets of cards. The first card was the first one which we had. We learned a lot of things from that. The second card, we're now getting it at no cost. Why? Because we learned a lot of things from that card that we're able to apply in the second card. Now, what you have in the second card, first of all, is a tripartite relationship between Centenary Bank, Visa, and NSSF, a 3-in-1. 2 allows you to use it as a debit card on the ATM machine. That allows you to carry a number of things, loyalty points and so on. It's actually a good card for somebody to have at this time in time. So the lessons we learned from the first card, we're able to apply it on the second card.
So you're saying that the card can be used by the holder to go to the bank?
Yes, to go to the bank.
To the ATM machine.
The ATM machine and withdraw money. You can preload money on your card. If you want to order things from Amazon, it's a Visa card. It will work as a Visa. And you can order anything. You want to go charge on a plane, you travel and you want to use it, you can use it as long as there's money that has been loaded on the card.
Is that for specific bankers? Let's say if you're doing Centenary Bank.
But remember, Visa is a platform.
Yes.
The number of banks that are using Visa as their platform, some of their ATMs and so on. So as long as there is a Visa platform, you can access it, whether in Uganda, in Kenya, or the US.
Okay. So what is the mistake that the former MD was talking about?
No. You were saying that card didn't work because there's certain things we hadn't taken into account. We took into account in the new card that we had.
So you have a new card now?
Yes, we have a new card. You can apply for it and get it.
And that's the one you're saying that you can take to the bank?
It is a Visa card.
Card, okay. So the one he was talking about was not Visa.
Was not Visa. Those are the lessons. Those are some of the lessons that we learned from the other that we were able to apply in this other one.
When did you roll out that one?
Which one?
The new one.
The new one last year. Last year, I believe, mid last year. Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And then, following the introduction of the midterm access provision, how has it been received by the savers?
No, that midterm was actually a blessing to a lot of people. Remember, midterm was rolled out right when the country was reopening up after COVID. And there are so many people who had gone through so much stress. Could be medical bills, school fees. People were stressed. People were actually going through a hard time. And the money came in on time. And sometimes you don't think about, I'll give you an example of a man who had, I think at about 8 million shillings, 20% of that is 1.6 million shillings. Now you may say, 1.6 million shillings, what did that man actually do with that money? I was kind of keen on following up to find out what he did with his money. And he made a statement that I had never even thought about. He said, for the first time, my child, I paid the full tuition that child would not be called to the bursar's office and sent home. Because tuition has not been paid. And I remember because I remember those times when it was so embarrassing to be called to the bursar's office and sent home. And you say, for that one term, that father had a peace of mind because of midterm. What do you pay for that? And there were little stories like that we realize it actually had a major impact. And then global, when you think about from a global perspective, between March, because the law was amended in January. We had 60 days to have the systems ready. So we began paying March. Between March and June, we paid 22,000 Ugandans midterm. 450 billion shillings, which was then pumped into the economy. So from an aggregate perspective, even the economy that was struggling to recover gets a bit of a jolt because people got their midterm.
Would you say that majority of those eligible for that midterm access took it up?
Yes. What we know that initially we thought there were going to be about 45,000 who were eligible. By the end of June, about 22,000 had applied. As of the end of December, that number is closer to 30,000. So that's around 75% of the people who were eligible have come for that money.
So how about those who have not yet come for their money? Have you planned for them?
No, I mean, right now, paying midterm is business as usual. We don't have to plan anything different. You want to, if you become eligible, come apply, you get your money, no problem.
So has the provision of the midterm access had an impact on your planning or the operations of the fund?
The only thing that happened with that was a bit of a reduction on income. Why? Because when we thought 45,000 Ugandans could come, we began to plan for them so it would be liquid enough that when they come, there's actual cash. So instead of investing in the long-term bonds, 10-year, 15-year bonds, we began investing in 3 months, 6-month bonds, so that when the members came, there was cash to pay them. Now, if you know anything, the short-term bonds give you lower interest than the long-term bonds. So there was a bit of a dip in the income for that year because we're planning for them. We didn't know how many were going to show up, but for sure wanted to make sure that when they came, they got their money.
Okay. Do you have voluntary membership in your fund?
Yes. One of the things the amendments gave us was anybody, anywhere can save with the fund today. We are now finalizing the regulations. Once the regulations are finalized and then they are gazetted, we roll out a whole slew of what I call a buffet of benefits for those who want to save voluntarily.
What more can be done to onboard workers that are not mandated to be contributing to the fund, but you know that they are the largest in the economy and they are in the working population?
One thing that we've done actually this whole year is study. A market vendor has different needs. You can't tell a market vendor come and save with NSSF and they will. His or her needs are different. So is a fisherman, so is a farmer. So what we're doing is we are crafting, like I said, a buffet of benefits. So when I go to that market vendor, I can say, you know what? You can save some money for retirement. You can also open up an account where if you wake up that morning and you need 500,000 shillings for capital for that day to stock, you can go 500,000, take it, trade it, you can bring it back. So it is the flexibility that you build into the products you offer. And as we do that, we become more in tune, relevant to what they do, and they will save with us.
Yes. Apart from that, are there any other benefits that such onboard workers would have?
Oh, yeah. What we're trying to actually put together is that if one of the things I've talking about, some people like would prefer to have some health cover, some insurance cover. Because we're aggregating a lot of people, we can make them more affordable for them to have some level of medical cover, some level of some funeral cover, so that you bring when you, that's what I'm saying, you cannot go to them and just say, retire, save for your retirement. But I can say, you know what? Here is a 1 million shilling cover. If you are not feeling well and you go to the hospital, at least you know that 1 million shillings is there for you to do what? To take care of that medical bill while you're there. So it's a mixture of things we're trying to bring to the members when we roll it out.
When do you hope to have these regulations in place so that it can actually be operational?
I think within the next 2 months it will be out. And then from there we roll it out because we have the products ready.
So within the next 2 months is
the
about,
regulations will be out?
It's about April?
About April. Yes.
So people should be able to come and apply for voluntary membership and be able to
get some of
have those benefits.
Exactly.
Okay. Thank you very much, Mr. Patrick Ayota. He's still here with me. We are going to have a short break while he updates us about the NSSF. And we are checking on them. I am Vivian Kamsimi. Thank you.